What we want to do next here is, I want you to have an understanding of where the quadratic formula comes from, because that's the next way that we're going to solve quadratic equations, is using the quadratic formula. So I want to take you through how they came up with it, so you'll have an understanding of where this formula came from. They just didn't, you know, pull it out of the air somewhere. So we're going to derive the quadratic formula, and we're going to start off with the standard form of a quadratic equation, which is ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. All right, that is my standard form of a quadratic equation. And guess what we're going to do? We're going to complete the square on this. All right, we just, you know, worked on two problems with completing the square. Now we're going to complete the square here. My first thing, is this in standard form? Yes. What's my next step here? I need a 1 right here where this a is. So what do I need to divide everything by? So we're going to come in here and divide each term by a. So we're going to get x squared plus b over ax plus c over a equals 0. What do you do next? Very good. Move your constant term, which is the c over a, to the other side. And when it crosses, it becomes what? It becomes negative, does it? Is everybody okay there? Now, what was our next step? What did we do? We want to do 1/2 of b over a, which is going to give me what? B over 2a, isn't it? 1/2 of b over a, you want to take 1/2 the linear coefficient, so 1/2 of b over a would be b over 2a. Now, what do I do with that b over 2a? Before you add it to both sides? Very good. Square what you got. So what's b times b would be b squared. What's 2a times 2a? 4a squared. And I'm going to put it in front here. And the reason why is because that c over a has a negative there. Does everybody see? I'm just going to put it in the front when I add it on this other side. Is everybody okay with that? Now again, what's 1/2 of b over a? 1 times b is b, 2 times a is 2a. Then if I square it, b times b is b squared, 2a times 2a is 4a squared, and we're just adding that to both sides here. Now what's my next step? Factor. So y squared gives me x squared. Y squared gave me b squared over 4a squared. And what's your sign right here? Plus. So does everybody see how I get x plus b over 2a? Y squared gives me x squared, it's x. Y squared gave me b squared over 4a squared was b over 2a, and then that first sign is a plus there. Doesn't matter. It's always this sign here. Yeah, you got to remember, it's always that sign. All right, now over here, what's your common denominator of 4a squared and a? Very good, 4a squared. A. You'll get an a. So now, this already had the common denominator. What are you going to have to multiply this by to get the 4a squared? 4a over 4a, so what do you get here? 4ac. All right, your common denominator for 4a squared and a is going to be 4a squared. This already had the 4a squared, so bring down the b squared. A times what is going to give you 4a squared? 4a. A times 4a is 4a squared. C times 4a would be your negative 4ac. Does everybody follow what I did there? Just a common denominator. Now what do you do? Take the square root of both sides. Don't forget your plus or minus. So on the left-hand side, we get x plus b over 2a plus or minus. I'm going to rewrite the radical. Now get caught up with me to there. Now, what do you get here in your denominator over here? Now what do you need to do? Bring this b over 2a over. And what do you notice they already have here? Common denominator. So we get negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all of that over 2a. And guess what that right there is? Guess what that is? Very good. That is your quadratic formula. I'm going to write it real small to make you have to hunt for it. That is your quadratic formula. And that's what we're going to be using next to solve quadratic equations. Isn't that pretty cool? At least now you know where it came from. I used to hate it when teachers would say, okay, this is the formula. I'd always be like, where did that come from? How'd you get that? Alright, so does everybody see how we got the quadratic formula? This is also in your book. If you're looking there, they always will work it out in your book, and it's in your book on page 151 there, deriving the quadratic formula. But I like to go through it because I like for you to see where it came from. Okay, now, next thing we're going to do is we're going to use this quadratic formula to solve quadratic equations. So solve by using the quadratic formula. Now down here at step 4 where we have simplify, you need to remember that you want to leave your answers in reduced radical form and in lowest terms. All right. Solve by using the quadratic formula. Get your equation in standard form, which is ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. Get your values for a, b, and c. What do you think your values for a, b, and c are? A is what? The coefficient on the quadratic. B is the what? Coefficient on the linear. And c is what? The constant term. So get your values for a, b, and c. Then plug into your quadratic formula. Simplify, leave your answer in reduced radical form and in lowest terms. And you will see that in just a few minutes here. Alrighty. So y'all be ready to do one? Y'all ready to do one? Okay, here we go. Let's say we have this one. All right, are we in standard form? Yes, isn't that descending order equal to zero? So what is your A value here? 3, what's your B value? -4, and what's your C? -6. Always bring your signs down with your numbers here, your coefficients and your constant there. Now, I would recommend, until you get it memorized, that you write the quadratic formula somewhere on here where you can have it to look at. Negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all of that over 2a. Now again, I would recommend that you put it somewhere where you have it there. Now, what do I do next? You want to get your A, B, and C and plug them in here. Negative B, so it's going to be a negative of B plus or minus the square root of B squared, and B is negative 4, minus 4 times, what's my A value? 3, and what's my C value? Negative 6 over 2 times what's my A value? 3. So everybody see you just plug in your A, B, and C's here. Okay, what do we do now? Simplify. What's a negative negative 4? Positive 4. What is negative 4 squared? 16. What's negative 4 times 3? Negative 12 times negative 6 is plus 72, and 2 times 3 is 6. We all right? So now, what's 16 plus 72? 16. Now, is everybody with me to here? Question, anyone? Is everybody all right there? Now, what's the largest perfect square factor in 88? What's the largest perfect square factor? Now, remember you got 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, 5 squared is 25, 6 squared is 36, 7 squared is 49, 8 squared is 64, 9 squared is 81, and then 10 squared is 100. Now, what I would recommend you do is get the calculator and go 88 divided by 4. Does 4 go into it? Yes, and it goes how many times? 22. Now, what do you know about the number 22? 22, the only factors are 2 and 11, right? So we've got the largest perfect square factor right here. Now, you can do 88 divided by 9, 88 divided by 16, and so on, but hopefully sometimes you can recognize that 4 times 22, the only other factors of 22 are 2 and 11, and they're not going to have, they're not a perfect square, are they? So now, x equals 4 plus or minus the square root of 4 times the square root of 22. And what's the square root of 4 right here? 2. So x equals 4 plus or minus 2, the square root of 22. Now we've got it in reduced radical form, but is this in lowest terms? What can you factor out of the numerator? Does everybody see that in my numerator, what can I factor out of 4 and 2? A 2. 2 times what gives me 4? 2. 2 times what gives me 2? 1. And you don't have to put the 1, but I'm putting it in there as a placeholder. Over 6. Now what can you do? Very good. 2 goes into 2, 1 goes into 6, 3. So what's my final answer? 2 plus or minus the square root of 22 over 3. Now, can I show y'all a common mistake? Do not do this. Students will go, oh, well, 4, 2 goes into that, goes into that. You cannot cancel like that. Do not do that. You've got to remember, what is this right here? Plus or minus. If you've got x plus 3 over 3, can you cancel those 3's? No. Remember that plus, that x plus 3, they're together. It's like a family. Think of that as a family. You cannot go and cancel within a family. Does everybody see how you got plus and minus in here? That makes that numerator a family. The only time you can do cancellation is when you have what? Multiplication. See how we factored out the 2? It's 2 times this, so now I can cancel the 2's. Think of the Sopranos. This right here is a family. If you wipe out the 3 and you don't wipe out the X, then guess what's going to happen? X is going to come looking for you, all right? But if you've got a situation like this where the 3 is not part of the family, he's left the family, what can you do to him? Wipe him out and there's not anybody left to come looking for you. Again, do not cancel within that family. An addition and subtraction is a what? Family there. Does everybody see this one? We okay there? All right, let's do another one here. Let's do number 74 in thy book on page 161. All right, are we in standard form here? Yes, aren't we in descending order equal to 0? All right, so now what is your A value? 1, what's your B value? Negative 2, and what's your C value? 7. A is your coefficient on the quadratic, B is the coefficient on the linear, and C is the constant. And always bring down those signs with you. That's a 17, Mr. Harris. Sorry, I was on the short bus. I was in the back next to Tammy on the short bus. So now, what did I tell you need to write out here to the side somewhere? We're going to plug into this. All right, so we ready? So this is going to be x equals, how about y'all plug into it, and then we'll see how you do, okay? I'll give y'all a second to plug into it. All right, you should have had negative b plus plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c, all that over 2 times a. So did everybody have something like this? Now, what's a negative negative 2 going to be? Very good, positive 2. What's negative 2 squared? 4, and negative 4 times 1 is negative 4 times 17 is negative 68. And what is 4 minus 68? Negative 64. Now, is everybody with me to there? Does everybody see how I got to this? Is everybody okay to hear? Now, what's the square root of negative 64? Very good. It's going to be 8i. So does everybody see how that's going to be 8i, isn't it? Now, when you have an imaginary, you want to get your answer in complex number form. Who remembers what complex number form is? A plus BI form, right? So what you want to do here is you want to put the 2 over 2 plus or minus 8 over 2i. And how does this reduce? One plus or minus 4i. Again, you want to get your answer in A plus BI form. So you need to break that fraction back up, put each one of them over the common denominator there. Is everybody okay there? So how do you feel about quadratic formula? Okie dokie. Quadratic formula is the quickest, easiest way to solve a quadratic equation. But you're going to have to know how to complete the square, and you're going to have to know how to use quadratic formula, because you'll be tested on both of those methods, all right? Now, the next thing we want to look at before we get into some application problems is we want to talk about something called the discriminant. Here, the discriminant is b squared minus 4ac. That is your discriminant, b squared minus 4ac. When you evaluate b squared minus 4ac and it's greater than 0, then you have two unequal real solutions. Or if you evaluate it and it equals 0, you've got one real solution. Or if you evaluate it and it's less than 0, then you've got two complex or two imaginary solutions, whichever way your instructor wants you to call it, two complex or two imaginary. So, if I had this problem, and I want to know what type of solutions I'm going to have before I solve it, I want to know what type of solutions. Well, tell me, what is your A value here? A is 4. What is B? Negative 3. And what is C? 2. Does everybody see my A, B, and C here? So I'm going to plug into B squared minus 4AC. So this would be negative 3 squared minus 4 times A times C. So I get 9 minus, what is that, 32? Because 4 times 4 is 16, times 2 is 32. What is 9 minus 32? 23. So what am I going to have here? Am I going to have two unequal real solutions? Am I going to have one real solution? Or am I going to have two complex imaginary solutions? Very good. You would say either you're going to have two complex solutions, depending on your instructor, or two imaginary solutions. So does everybody understand the discriminant? You just are plugging into B squared minus 4AC and looking to see which one of those holds. Does everybody see how we got negative 23? Is negative 23 greater than 0? No. Is negative 23 equal to 0? No. Is negative 23 less than 0? Yes. So that tells you you got two complex imaginary solutions. Does everybody see how easy that is? Alrighty then. Turn in thy book to page... Let's go over to page 163, I think is where I want to go. And before we do some of the word problems, one of the things I want to go over with you is something called the Pythagorean Theorem, just as a refresher. If I have a right triangle, and that's a triangle with a 90-degree angle. So everybody see here I have a right triangle, don't I? Okay. The two sides that form that 90-degree angle are called legs. And the side opposite the 90-degree angle is called the hypotenuse. The two sides that form the 90-degree angle are called legs. The side opposite the 90-degree angle is called the hypotenuse. Well, your Pythagorean theorem says that if you come in here and you square each leg and add those together, it will equal your hypotenuse squared. Leg squared plus leg squared has to equal hypotenuse squared. Now, more commonly, what do we do here? We label the hypotenuse as C, and our legs as A and B, and we say A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Does everybody remember your Pythagorean theorem? All right, look on page 163. At problem number 142. It says the base of a 30-foot ladder is 10 feet from a building. If the ladder reaches the flat roof, how tall is the building? All right. So what we've got here Alright, there's my building, and I've got what? A ladder leaning against this building, right? Here's my ladder. How long is that ladder? The ladder here is 30 feet long, isn't it? How far is the ladder from the building? 10 feet. So what I'm trying to find is, and I'm going to use an X here because we assume that's going to make a 90-degree angle there. I want to find the height of my building here. Just so you'll know it's a building, we'll put a couple of windows. okay? So what's your Pythagorean theorem? We know it's a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Well, if I let a be x and b be 10, and we know c is always the hypotenuse, then x squared would equal 30 squared minus 10 squared, right? If I move the 10 squared over. So what are you going to get here? This would be x squared equals 900 minus 100. So x squared equals 800. Very good. Take the square root of both sides. Now, why do I not worry about the negative? Because hopefully this building ain't sinking, right? So we want it to be positive. So in your calculator, take the square root of 800. And what did it say round to? It didn't. So roughly 28.28 feet. Does everybody see this? How did I put it in the calculator? Do second x squared, which gets your square root, 800, and hit enter. Does everybody see this one okay? All right, we're going to have to skip to my fun one. All right, let's go down and do problem number 152. These are my favorites out of all these word problems. All right, you ready? It says, a machine produces open boxes using square sheets of metal. The machine cuts equal-sized squares measuring 3 inches on a side from the corners and then shapes the metal into an open box by turning up the sides. If each box must have a volume of 75 cubic inches, find the length and width of the open box. Now, what you got to do here is visualize. You've got a square piece of metal here, and they're coming in here, and they're cutting out little 3-inch square corners. And they're folding that remaining metal there. They're folding this remaining metal, and that remaining metal up. Does everybody see how they're going to fold up and make flaps of a what? The sides of a, not the flaps, but the sides of a box. So what you've got here is when they fold those up, you've got this box. Does everybody understand what's happening there? Now, these corners that they're cutting away are what? 3 inches by what? 3 inches? Because what is the length there of that flap right there? 3. So your height here has to be 3 inches high. Because, does everybody understand? If I cut away these 3-inch corners, then that length right there is how much? 3 inches, which is going to have to be the height of the box. Now, if I start with a square piece of metal, and I cut away the same corners, then what do I know about the base of that box? It's still going to have to be a what? It's still going to have to be a square, isn't it? If you start with a square, and you cut away the same things, then what's that still going to have to be there, the base of that box? It's going to have to be a square. So how do you get volume? It's length times width times height, isn't it? So look up here at my box. What is my length? We'll say that's the length. What is my length? X. What's my width? We'll say that's the width. X. And what's my height? 3. So my volume is 3x squared, because length times width times height. Why does it tell me the volume of the box has to be? So now what can I do? Divide by? All right, I can divide by 3, and now I need to do what? Take the square root of both sides. So the question was, find the length and width of the open box. So what would have to be the length of the box? What would have to be the width? And we already know the height was what? Isn't that pretty cool? I like problems like this. A lot. Does everybody see this one? A lot of times when you read these, they're intimidating when you first read them, but this one was not that bad if you can draw it out and visualize. All right, y'all ready to do one more? Let's look in thy book and do problem number... Number 146 on page 163. Problem 146. Now here it says a rectangular parking lot has a length that is 3 yards greater than the width. The area of the parking lot is 180 square yards. Find the length and the width. So if I've got a parking lot here, may not be a rectangle, but what the heck. All right. So what do we know about this rectangular parking lot? If I let this be the width, which is going to be W, then what do I know about the length here? Doesn't it say it's 3 yards? It has a length that is 3 yards greater. So it'd have to be W plus 3. How do you get area? So what's my area supposed to be here? 180 square yards. What's my length? W plus 3. What's my width? W. Does everybody see how I just plugged in what I knew there? Now, what is W times W? W squared. And what's W times 3? Now, is this in standard form? No. What do you need to do here? Bring the 180 over. Now, guys, you can use quadratic formula, completing the square, whatever you want to here, but this one happens to factor this one here is going to factor, then set each factor, because we're about to run out of time, so let me just work through this one. Set each factor equal to 0. Which one of those widths is going to work? Well, I want the negative 15. It's negative. So my width would have to be, was that in yards? 12 yards. And what would have to be my length? Very good. Go back and put 12 for W, and what's 12 plus 3? 15 yards. Those aren't too bad, are they? I kind of like them. Alrighty. If you'll turn with me in your book here for just a minute, turn to page 160 and 161. On 15 through 34, you're solving by taking square roots, like we did at the beginning. On 35 through 46, they're just asking you what would you add there to complete the square. So look at number 35. What's a half of 12? 6. What's 6 squared? 36. So all they're looking for there is the plus 36. Does everybody follow? That's all they're wanting you to do. They're not wanting you to do it. They're just wanting you to find what you would add to complete the square. Like on number 37, what's a half of 10? 5 squared is? So you just put plus 25, okay? Then on 47 through 64, you're solved by completing the square. Have fun with those. And then on 65 through 74, it's the quadratic formula. 75 through 82 is using the discriminant. And then 83 through 108, that's a hodgepodge there, okay? You get to practice whatever one will work there. And then you've got, you know, the lovely word problems here. So is everybody okay here with section 1.5?